And welcome to the 14th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received this morning from Natalie Dawn, and I'm pleased to say Evelyn Tweed is attending as her substitute. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. The next agenda item is on adult disability payment, which is due to start replacing personal independence payment in Scotland next year. Changes will be made through regulations, which the committee expects to be laid soon. And this morning, we will consider the differences between ADP and PIP and any potential policy issues in advance of formal consideration of the regulations next year. I'm pleased to say we will hear from two panels today. I welcome to the first panel Ed Pybus, who is Policy and Parliamentary Officer for the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, Richard Gass, Welfare Rights and Money Advice Manager from Rights Advice Scotland, and Judith Patterson, the Member of the Scottish Commission on Social Security. A very warm welcome to you all to the committee. Can I ask both committee members and panellists to type R for request to speak in the chat box if you would like to come in. Some members have already indicated to me in advance that they would like to do so. I would also appreciate it, given that we are virtual today, if colleagues asking questions could direct their questions to witnesses directly, please, and also make sure you allow a wee bit of time to ensure that your microphones are turned on before speaking. So the first question I will turn to is from Pam Duncan-Glancy, please, followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning, convener, and good morning, panellists. Thanks very much for joining us this morning. We note in the regulations for adult disability payment that some of them, indeed a lot of them, do mirror PIP. Where the regs differ, can the panel comment on whether or not they believe they support or help the end user? And also, some of the changes in adult disability payment from PIP, including terminal illness rule, the fact that awards don't end immediately, rules on armed forces, residence rules and so on, do represent a policy divergence from the UK. What is your understanding of how the SG and Scottish Government were able to progress on those areas, given some of the constraints that we've heard around implementing different policy from the UK Government? And could I please ask Ed Pybus and also Judith Patterson, please, to respond? Thanks.
Thanks, Pam. Thanks, Neil, and thanks for the invite to the committee. As Pam said, the rules, the eligibility rules largely follow the PIP rules. I guess to answer the last question, I don't know discussion that's been had between the Scottish Government and the DWP that's allowed some change to happen, but we welcome, for example, the change around the extension of terminal illness, for example, hopefully will help more people. I guess where there's been quite a lot of change is around the process, around the way decisions, the rules around making new determinations and stuff like that. And we'll have to wait and see how that all beds in, I guess, to see how that works. Where there are differences and where there might be problems is around case law. So a lot of the PIP rules are built up around case law for the PIP regulations. And the Scottish Government has tried to incorporate some of that in regulation, but obviously incorporating case law into regulation isn't always easy. And there's a few areas where we feel that the definitions could be tightened up to make sure it is more in line with PIP. A key one of those is around pain, and case law is established that if you can't do something without being in pain, then you shouldn't be considered to be able to do it. And under the definition of acceptable standard, that could include a reference to pain. It doesn't at the moment, and we'd hope that the PIP case law will carry on into the ADP case law and establish that. But to put it beyond doubt, including stuff like that in the regulations would be potentially helpful to clients and also to the agency and to decision makers to make it clear exactly what should be taken into account when making decisions.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much for that. Judith Patterson, please.
And I think on a broader point about the changes to terminal illness and residence rules, I think there's a kind of direction of travel in the UK as well in those areas. So in the UK, they're also widening eligibility for people who are terminally ill. They're widening residence rules, not in PIP, but in DLA, which is being propelled by case law. So I think Scotland making improvements in ADP in these areas, there was more of a sense of alignment, if not entire alignment with the rest of the UK. In terms of whether the sort of detail of the regulations is always where that differs, if it's always of benefit to the claimant, I think Ed's talked about case law, which is absolutely relevant. There's various phrases in the regulations that have been changed to incorporate case law, and I think pretty much yes, that is beneficial. And if that's when Scots looked at it, that was clearly the intention that we could see, but it's a difficult job, and I think it does have to be done with some care, because if you incorporate case law, then that can change things in ways that can be unexpected in itself. So I think they've taken a fairly careful approach, but that seems to be reasonable to us. But the regulation changes about decision making, they're all drafted differently in Scotland, in Scottish Social Security, from PIP. So they don't mirror PIP in the same way as the eligibility rules do. When you drill into the detail of those decision-making changes, most of them, I would say, are neutral. So that does follow the policy intention. But Scots did report on one change that did seem to us to be detrimental. So it's detailed. But it's one of our recommendations that should be attended to. And it basically, it meant in some circumstances, fairly, somebody could lose out in a few weeks' money because of the way the regulations have been drafted. We don't, of course, know. We've made that recommendation. We don't at this point know what the Scottish Government's response to that recommendation might be.
Thank you very much indeed, Judith. I can see, Pam, you're looking to come back in.
Briefly, Convener, thank you, if you will. Thank you, that's really, really helpful. And would perhaps Richard and Ed be able to comment on where they see the eligibility mirroring PIP and the impact that has on the people that they represent?
Richard Gass?
Yes, thank you. At the end of the day, the eligibility rules are near identical. It's more the process rules that have been changed, and we welcome those process rules changes. But what we've got is PIP as it was, just transposed into a Scottish format. And in answer to the member's question, how does that affect our clients? And it's the fact that these benefits were being devolved. We've been expecting them for quite some time. There was anticipation about improvement, and we've not had that improvement yet. We're lifting what was a benefit entitlement that the welfare rights and claimants would criticise for having inadequacies, and we've recast that. And I understand the idea of safe and secure transition, but it feels like safe and secure transition has been a justification for not being sufficiently ambitious. Child disability payment is already in place, and there were some tweaks to that. For example, the extension of entitlement to over 16s, which would require an element of reassessment for such clients. So the issue of introducing something that requires some reassessment is not alien. And I just feel that opportunity has been lost. And if I could maybe labour on that particular point, it's in relation to the mobility component. Many claimants were on disability living allowance, moved over to PIP, and lost their mobility component or their higher rate mobility component at that stage. Something that we'd hoped that the new system would rectify, but it's not rectified that. And I think that there's an opportunity here for for the mobility element to be reviewed. And yes, it would require some reassessment, but it would be a reassessment for the good. I see that more recently there's concern about making change that would tie the hands of the review next year. However, there might be some fundamental principles that if mobility components should not be removed from claimants who previously had it, then that may be something that steers the mind of the review next year.
Thank you very much indeed, Richard. Ed, Pybus, please.
So just to kind of jump back on one of those slight changes where the rules are different. There's some slight changes around residence and presence conditions for people who are offshore workers or in the armed forces. And again, it would be good to kind of build into those changes because they're not necessarily all beneficial and could have a wider impact. I guess on that larger point, I guess other organisations are giving evidence on that in the next session, looking at potential changes. I think what's really important is to, in the meantime, take a look at the way the rules are being applied. And we know that often, unfortunately, in PIP decisions, people are being refused benefit and have to go to appeals to get it because, for example, as I mentioned earlier, this thing about pain and acceptable standard isn't being taken into account when you're looking at someone walking. You know, if someone can only walk in pain, then they should be getting a high rate of mobility. And under PIP, that doesn't happen because the rules aren't being followed correctly by decision makers. So we need to make sure in the Scottish system that not only are the rules clear, but the guidance is absolutely clear for decision makers or case managers, as they'll be called in the Scottish system, and that there's an audit process to ensure that they're using the guidance and following the guidance and the decisions are being made that are correct. And I guess also another key part of the system, which we've been sort of discussing for a while, is making sure that the agency collect data on claims, on conditions and on outcomes of claims about people who get awards, what rate they get, and people who are refused awards. So when we are looking at this, we can look and see, well, hang on a minute, people are not getting the award they should be getting. Certain groups, for example, people with MS aren't getting the high rent mobility. We need to look at that. So it's gathering that evidence, I guess, to make sure that changes can be made. I guess we've broadly accepted the Scottish Government's weighing up of the advantages around changes compared to disruption, and they've gone with a safe and secure transition, but Richard's absolutely right, small changes can be made in the system. Doesn't have to wait until the outcome of a formal review before that happens.
Thank you very much indeed, Ed. I can see Judith Patterson, you're looking to come in here briefly as well.
Thank you, yes. I mean, Scots is very aware that introducing adult disability payment is an opportunity to do better than the benefit it replaces, and we're very aware that people want to seize that opportunity, make improvements, and Scots shares that ambition. But we were persuaded in the course of our scrutiny that the critical priority in the short term was actually to make sure that people had the confidence that their payments without disruption. And we felt, having listened to everyone that we could listen to, that doing too much too soon could destabilise delivery and put that at risk. Did in the end conclude that it was right to go ahead as planned and look to make those changes once that initial period of transition was concluded.
Thanks very much, Judith. Just while you're on that point, before I bring in Jeremy Balfour, Scots said in the report that we're persuaded that changing eligibility criteria at this time would risk undermining the delivery of ADP with extremely detrimental consequences for people who depend on it. What did you envisage in terms of those detrimental consequences? So essentially, what was it that made you reach that conclusion?
I think it is the issue about stability of payments, as Richard and Ed have kind of suggested, that if you change eligibility criteria, then as people transfer from their existing PIP to adult disability payment, they have to be assessed. And there are 300,000 people to be transferred over, and everything is new. So there are so many new systems to get up and running, to test, to make sure they're working. But that if you introduce too much too soon, then some of those critical paths would mean that there are delays to payments or that people drop out altogether. And we've seen with other transfers in the UK system that it's a difficult process. And one of the things that people don't want and causes problems is to have to apply for the new benefit during the process of transfer. I think it's very clear to us that people want to be transferred and not have to claim their new benefit with all the uncertainty that that brings along with it. So I think that was what was most persuasive for us.
That's extremely helpful. Thank you very much. Jeremy Balfour for his set of questions, please.
Good morning, Kavina. Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming along. I've got three questions, which I'll maybe just take separately. And the first one, I think, will probably be for either Richard or Judith, but Ed, feel free to jump in if you wish. It's just going back to the issue around case law. We've had quite a long debate about this over the last number of years, because clearly there has been a lot of case law built up over the last 15, 20 years. Is it your understanding that the new agency and the new tribunals will be following that case law, or is the situation still unclear? And maybe, Richard, you could start with you.
Richard Gass, please.
Yes, thank you. As we've adopted the regulations almost verbatim, with some process changes, the entitlement rules remain the same, and I would therefore expect that the tribunals will be applying the same case law. At present, you know, we do have a Scottish legal system, and it differs in part to the UK, but by and large, that doesn't really impact on Social Security legislation. So I would imagine that the existing case law would, until some point where our entitlements diverge, continue to apply.
Ed Pybus, did you have anything to add, as was suggested?
I guess we don't know is the answer, and it'll be up to the tribunals, which are independent of Social Security Scotland, how they manage it. But I agree with Richard, but because the legislation is in many cases drafted identically or very similar, they would follow PIP case law. I guess where it gets slightly more complicated is if PIP case law starts to diverge, if there's further significant case law that happens for PIP after the transfer, how that applies. So I think one of our calls is that there needs to be a kind of constant review process happening to review the regs and see if case law is diverging and what needs to be done about that. Doesn't mean we have to follow it, because obviously that the point is in Scotland, they can do things differently, but at least a decision has to be made around that.
Thanks very much. Jeremy, do you have a further question?
Yes, a couple more. I mean, I think that's an interesting point raised by Ed, because obviously decisions ultimately are made in the Supreme Court on these decisions. And so it will be interesting to see how the Supreme Court interprets two sets of different regulations, but that maybe for more legal eagles around. The second question is aimed at Judith. Judith, I was interested in your last point that you made about the safe transfer, which we all clearly want to happen, and that's kind of overridden your view and the Commission's view that we shouldn't have any changes. Can I just ask, how did you come to that decision? Was that a kind of consultation with the third sector? Was that a kind of pragmatic view that the Commission came to? I'm just wondering if you could maybe expand a little on how you came to that view.
Judith Paston, sure. Please.
We discussed, did have a consultation with stakeholders, and we looked at those views very carefully, and there certainly are strong views that there should be changes made more quickly. So, and the 20-metre rule featured quite strongly in that, as did issues for people with maybe intermittent conditions. We also pressed the Scottish Government quite hard on this point. They had engagement with officials and with the Minister and with the Cabinet Secretary at various points, and we had briefings from them. We had very detailed and helpful information back on the rationale for why the approach was being taken that it was. So we did do our best, we felt, because we were very aware that this was a critical question for the committee and for stakeholders. So we did try and take a broad view. Was it pragmatic? I think practical, I suppose I would say, that we were looking at risks and we were very focused on money in people's pockets and the experience for people. And in truth, we were also aware that there are a lot of features in the system that should be better and have addressed some of the main concerns that the Scottish Government heard during its initial consultation from people about what they didn't like, you know, face-to-face reviews and so forth, and those were being addressed.
Thank you very much, indeed, Judith.
Thank you.
All right, sorry, Jeremy, as you can see, Richard Gass is looking to come in, and then I'll bring you in for your further question.
Thank you. No, it's just, again, the safe and secure transition, not making change unnecessarily to allow it to land, but the issue with the mobility component is bigger than that, because what we have are, we've got claimants who are still on disability living allowance, and we've got claimants who have been transferred to PIP. Those who have transferred possibly have lost. Those who have not transferred have not yet lost. We're trying to bring two benefits into a new Scottish benefit, and there's a conundrum here. What's the rules about mobility for somebody who's currently on DLA, who can walk no more than 50 metres, but in excess of 20 metres? How do they land safe and securely into the new adult disability payment? And then we've got to measure that up against the fact that we've got child disability payment, which still has the rules as old. So you could have 16 and 17 year olds who are getting the higher mobility component on the basis of being virtually unable to walk somewhere between 20 and 50 metres. When they're reassessed on their ADP claims, they will need to have that removed. So it's not a, well, this is where we are, how do we move forward? This is an emerging problem and something I think needs to be resolved promptly.
Thank you, Richard. Jeremy, sorry for cutting you off.
No, thank you, Richard. I think that's really helpful comments. I mean, I think it is disappointing. I think you go back 5 years ago to when Jean Freeman was in charge and when this was starting, it was very much going to be a very different system. And I do think the government has lost its way on this, particularly around the 20-metre rule and particularly around those with available conditions. But on the presumption that these regulations will be passed by the SNP Green government, then can I ask maybe Judith and Richard and Ed, with the review taking place in 2022-23, do you think it's possible that any recommendations that will be brought forward, such as changing 20 to 50, can be done within this parliament? Or do you think realistically we're looking at another 5-6 years before we see any change in regard to that? Just from your experience of how long it takes, I'm just wondering, can we do it in a 4-year period, or is that over-optimistic?
Maybe thank you very much. Thank you. Assuming that was your final question, Jeremy, I'll note to broadcast colleagues, I'm looking to Marie McNair next, and I'll bring Judith Patterson, followed by Richard Gass, followed by Ed Pybus, please. Judith.
Oh, sorry. Can it be done within this Parliament? Well, I think there's more chance of that if the Scottish Government the ground for that now. I don't think there's any reason not to get that underway. It is an independent review that's being proposed. It's being proposed it'll start in 2023, not much more than a year's time. So the more that can be done now to scope that review, the better. So, for example, all that stakeholder feedback, all that rich evidence that the Scottish Government has had could be used as a starting point to identify those areas of particular concern where improvements could be made. and the Scottish Government could start thinking about commissioning some research into those areas, scheduling experience panels, for example, client panels, consultation exercises. But also they could usefully be looking at some of the constraints, because we've talked a bit about the constraints that exist now in terms of safe and secure transfer, but there are other constraints that might not go away after transition. And for example, to do with the interactions between adult disability payment and UK benefits, passporting issues. So some of that early scoping work, looking at what the constraints are, what can be moved, what can't, I think would be very useful for the independent, make it more likely that some changes could be made within this parliament.
Thank you very much indeed, Judith. Richard Gass, please, followed by Pybus.
I think the time frame is fairly ambitious, and to answer the question, is it achievable within that? Well, that depends on how much change is proposed within the review. If the review proposes a fundamental change, then that will require fairly detailed new legislation and all the scrutiny that goes with that. If it's new, fundamentally new legislation, then we will have winners and losers, and how do we then deliver on that? Does there need to be then transitional protection? So other possibilities that the review is fairly light touch and recognises, well, maybe not so much wrong with it, not that I would necessarily agree with that, but if it's just simply said that what we require is a single benefit from cradle to grave with nuances and tweaks at different age points along the way, that might be more easily delivered. That would be something sort of like going back to how it was before PIP was introduced. So the question then is, how ambitious are the changes? The more ambitious, the longer it takes. The less ambitious, the quicker it takes.
Thanks, Richard. Ed Pybus, please.
I don't know if I have much more to add, but I kind of agree. It depends on the ambition. I think, as Judith said, sorting out those issues around passporting is key to understanding what changes can be made. And it's certainly possible for review to look at maybe small changes that could be made that will bring some people that currently fall out with the system into the system, whilst also looking at bigger long-term structural changes that will take longer to implement. So I certainly some changes could be made in this parliament if there's a will.
Thanks very much, Ed. Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you for your attendance at the committee. It's very much appreciated. To help aid our understanding of the mobility 20-metre rule in PIP, this was introduced by the Tory government in Westminster. What was the rationale for introducing it, and was there any impact on the sort of assessment of it? I mean, and is there any kind of suggestion, will they move away from it now, given the condemnation of the policy?
Any particular member of the panel that you'd like to direct that to, Marie?
Could I put that to Ed Pybus and Richard Gass?
Ed, please.
I'm trying to think back to the introduction of PIP. I was frontline welfare rights worker at that point. I mean, I guess it's the change, there was a lot of changes when adults moved from DLA to PIP. Under DLA, there wasn't a kind of strict distance rule. It was more about being virtually unable to walk within regulations, but case law had established around 50 metres walking was about what that would cover, whereas PIP clarified that as a 20-metre rule. So I guess I don't feel I can accurately say exactly what the intention behind that was. I know maybe Judith and Richard have been involved for longer and may have knowledge on that. I don't think there's any I think Judith mentioned earlier that some of the changes that are happening in Scotland that have happened around terminal illness, etc., are areas that the UK government is looking at PIP. I'm not aware that the UK government is considering changes to mobility on a UK level. Certainly that wasn't particularly looked at, I don't think, in the Green Paper. But this, I guess, is another point, is what happens if the rules for PIP around the UK are changed. There is a Green Paper on assessment for disability and work benefits. And so what happens if once ADP is in place, rules around PIP change, I mean, you've got that also same problem of passporting. And one other problem that also comes up is transfers. If people move from Scotland to England or Wales, they have to reapply. And if the rules are very different, what that means for people moving as well is an issue. I think that's hopefully answered it.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much indeed, Ed. Richard Gass, please.
Yes, the change for PIP form part of the UK government's raft of welfare reforms as we were coming out of the recession, and we were advised that DLA for adults was no longer fit for purpose and needed to be recast. And at that time, there was a notion, I've tried to find the source, but I can't find the source, but there was a notion that these changes would bring about a 20% saving. So from the advisor and claimant community, this was seen as a change for the sake of saving money. And it seemed to be that the areas where the axe fell hardest was in relation to the mobility component. So this was, I would suggest it was one of the identified savings to be made. But 20 metres, it's correct that in the old legislation, we talked about virtually unable to walk, and it was case law that firstly established around 100 metres, and then latterly it came down to 50 metres as being the true definition of being virtually unable to walk, given other factors as well. But when PIP came in, it went down to 20 metres, and effectively 20 metres, what's that? 10 times the full stretch of your arm. If someone's only able to walk that particular distance, then it's almost becoming meaningless in terms of actual walking ability.
Thank you very much indeed, Richard. That's very helpful. Marie, do you have a further question?
Thanks, Karina. I do, yeah. Although there's already some welcome policy changes from PIP, the Scottish Government stated priority is a safe and secure transfer from the DWP to Social Security. I want to explore the kind of risk around transfer. Given your experience of the benefit system, can you comment on past experiences of transfer between the DWP benefits and did they meet their stated timescales?
Thanks very much, Marie.
Pop that back to Ed and Richard again, please.
I think we all know that the transfer from DLA to PIP has taken far, far longer than was planned. And that's meant we've got the situation, as I think Richard mentioned earlier, that we have adults in Scotland who are still getting disability living allowance who are going to have to be transferred, who haven't been transferred to PIP, who are going to have to move straight to adult disability payment. And that brings difficulties around that. I guess this comes back to the point Judith was making, in that the decision in Scotland to not get claimants to make a new claim for the Scottish benefit and end their PIP by just transferring them, hopefully makes that process far more straightforward and hopefully will happen far more quickly. But it does bring the difficulty that you can't really make changes to the eligibility criteria, or it's much harder to make changes to the eligibility criteria when you do that transfer. There's a couple of things we picked up in our submission to the Commission around the transfer. For example, around transfer of people over pension age who are on PIP who might have to be transferred. So there are a few difficult cases, and particularly the people around DLA who are being transferred, stuff like that. But I guess that is what we were talking about earlier, and the decision to keep the eligibility criteria makes it possible to transfer people rather than people weren't actually transferred to PIP. They had to claim PIP and then stop their DLA claim. It's a different process in Scotland. Whether it all takes time, we'll wait and see.
Thanks, Richard. Gaz, presumably also transferring onto Universal Credit as well as PIP.
Yes, the changes over my lifetime in welfare rights, which does go back to 1986, there's been a number of changes. Some of them have come about more promptly. In 86, the move from supplementary benefit over to income support, that seemed to my recollection was that happened in a far narrower window than the move to universal credit. In fact, universal credit was supposed to be done and dusted many years ago, but we're still nowhere near there. And I think that's the reason is that the more ambitious the change, the more difficult it is to deliver it, because it throws up a whole load of issues along the way. Simple changes, yes, bring them out easily. Complex changes, far longer. So our aspirations for the disability benefits, if we want to have something fundamentally different, then I think we're talking about quite some time. If we're looking at tinkering at the edges and maybe trying to remove some of the inequalities that have crept in, that's probably something that could be happening far faster.
Thank you very much indeed, Richard. I'm looking to bring in Faisal Chowdhury now, please. And Faisal Chowdhury now, then, please, who has indicated that he would like to ask a question as well. Faisal.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. And good morning, colleagues. I have a question for Judith. We accept no change until after safe and secure. Do you think the review of adequacy and eligibility needs to wait until after that too, or could the government be starting to review those things now so that the new system could push on straight after safe and secure transition?
Judith Patterson.
Yeah, I think you're quite right. I think there are things that can be done now. I think what other witnesses have said, what Richard has said about the scale of change is really important. So scoping out for the review now, what kind of change could be done in the medium term, and what kind of change is really very much a long term ambition, because it would take, for example, primary legislation. I think that groundwork can be done now. There's no reason why not. I think there are some areas that could be changed more easily, but I think a word of caution on that as well. I think it's going to be important to be able to test any changes to eligibility rules to make sure it's fully understood what the consequences would be for people. Something might look on the face of it like a very sensible improvement, but there can be unforeseen consequences. So it will be easier for the Scottish Government to test that when they've got their own live caseload of people on benefit, so they can do a kind of behind the scenes check on what that would mean if they moved things around.
Thank you, Judith. I can see Ed Pybus is looking to come back in on that point.
But has been done in the Scottish system is big changes to process, and those are things that can be changed and reviewed as it goes along. So, for example, the agency collecting medical evidence or other formal evidence from people. Let's see how that works. And if we immediately start to see it causes a backlog of evidence requests to third sector organisations, for example, those processes can be changed. So I think the processes that are in place that are new need to be very much dynamic and changeable as feedback comes from the system as it works.
Thank you very much indeed. Ed, Jeremy Balfour, please.
I just want to move on briefly to the issue around terminal illness, which was perhaps the biggest change that we had in the primary legislation. I just wonder, my understanding was, sadly there are a number of children who die with terminal illness, and the government was going to do a kind of deep dive to see how the system worked. I wonder if anyone knows how that has worked in practice. Has it made a difference for children who this was introduced first of all? And secondly, in regard to adults, and is there indications that the medical profession, and particularly consultants, GPs, nurses, are aware of these changes and signposting patients towards them? And perhaps maybe start with Richard for that one, if that's okay.
Yes, thank you. I'm not aware of the deep dive that's been done. However, I would like to think that if there was children who were very seriously terminally ill, then the old regulations prior to the introduction of child disability payment would have allowed them to succeed under the terminal illness rules for child DLA. We certainly welcome the expansion of the definition of terminal illness, and what that will do is allow more people in to the benefit who are indeed terminally ill, but there's maybe a reluctance on a consultant or a specialist to kind of limit that to a 6-month frame. But I would hope, as I said, that those who were very, very seriously ill, that the old rules would have been sufficient for them. I have no evidence to back that up. That's more a gut reaction. In relation to confusion with GPs, etc., I am aware that there was a GP practice in Perth who mistakenly believed that when the Perth went live for the pilot of the child disability payment, that the terminal illness rules changed for all claimants. And I know that that particular practice has been sending in the BASRIS, the Benefit Assistance Under Special Rules in Scotland, forms to DWP in England. I've not heard of anybody not getting the benefit as a consequence, but nor have we had any indication that DWP are seeking to get a DS 1500 filled in. But yes, there's certainly scope for confusion.
But
anyone else catching any information?
Jeremy?
I'm just wondering, I don't know if anyone else, Ed or Judith, has anything they want to add to that.
No indication thus far.
I'm done then. That's me. Thank you.
Thank you. Marie McNair, please.
Thanks, Convener. I welcome the Scottish Government approach to terminal illness. It takes a more compassionate approach, but also, as far as I understand, a more generous approach by awarding the enhanced rates of mobility component and the daily living component for PIP. Is there any concern that this difference could create confusion, and how do we minimise this? Is there any indication that the Westminster Government intend to learn from the Scottish approach to terminal illness policy?
Any particular panel member that would be addressed to?
To anyone, sorry, convener.
If any colleague who is wishing to come in at that stage could type R in the chat function, that would be helpful so that we can have an indication of anyone who'd wish to respond to that point. Ed Pybus, please. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I think Richard got in first, but that's fine. I think there is, as we've kind of discussed, potential for confusion and particularly around people who are getting both DWP and Scottish benefits. So that has to be monitored, I guess, and make sure it's clear understanding with the DWP and their staff about what should be happening. I understand that there is some kind of review happening around terminal illness at UK level, but it's colleagues in London who will be dealing with that. So I can certainly get back to you, Marie, if find out a bit more from them. I guess another, as I previously made a point about process, this is a new approach in Scotland to terminal illness, and it needs to be, data needs to be collected on the process as it goes along, and it needs to be reviewed to see how well it is working. Are medical professionals able to fill in the two separate forms or have the two different definitions of terminal illness? I'm sure the Chief Medical Officer will be keeping a close eye on how the guidance is being implemented in practice, and that's important to make sure that the system works as intended.
Thanks, Ed. Richard Gass, please, before I bring Marie back in, if she has another question.
Yes, thank you. I was going to say that what's required here is an element of dialogue between Social Security Scotland and DWP to ensure that there is, where possible, dovetailing of the systems. Judith alluded earlier that there is a review for the UK government in terms of how they're going to redefine terminal illness. But regardless of what they do, we could still have two things that are slightly different. For a claimant who's moved over to a Scottish disability benefit, then they won't require a DS 1500 for the UK disability benefit because that's changed. But where there could be overlap would be if they're also claiming universal credit on the grounds of being unfit for work. What we need, and this is where the dialogue would come in, we need assurances from DWP that they're going to be content to accept a BASRIS form as evidence of someone's terminal illness in relation to the way they will process the universal credit, and it won't be the case that they will then say, well, actually, we need to now establish if contents of the barristers can be narrowed down to a six-month window.
Thanks, Richard. Marie McNair, do you have a further question before I bring in Miles Briggs?
No, that's just me for now for Team 3.
Thank you very much. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel as well. I think we all welcome this new approach to tackling to fast-tracking claims around terminal illness. So I wanted to specifically ask, SCOS has recommended that the Scottish Government set out how it will create a sustainable and seamless system for terminally ill people. So I wondered, and it's maybe a question for Judith specifically, how that work is going and has that actually been achieved?
Judith Patterson, please.
Yes, we did make that recommendation, and it was kind of about thinking about Social Security Scotland, the Scottish Government, and DWP departments working together. But we wanted to know for the Scottish end of that what that would look like. We've made that recommendation. We're still waiting to hear what the Scottish Government's response to that will be. So I'm afraid I don't have anything to add on that. But what departments working together, because any delay that's introduced into the system for terminally ill people has to be avoided at all costs. And I think everyone knows that. So there are obvious sources of confusion. Richard's spot on in the one that he's identified in Perth already. So both systems need to learn lessons really quickly and make improvements to the system really quickly.
Thanks, Judith. Miles Briggs.
That's helpful. And looking towards that, we've heard evidence from a number of organisations who work with people and their families who are being cared for, who have a terminal illness. And I wondered, to what extent do you feel they've been included in designing this system? For example, Marie Curie, who obviously are on the front line running hospices, for example. I wonder if you have any information about how they've been included, and that's to anyone on the panel.
Any colleagues looking to come in on that question from Mr. Briggs, looking for an R in the chat box if that is offered?
No. That's okay. Happy to move on.
Thanks, Miles. Have you any further questions, Miles? Sorry.
Yeah, that's me for now. Thanks.
Are you moving on to the next? You were first up on the next theme, if that's possible, Miles, around moving between DLA, PIP and ADP.
Yeah, happy to. Thank you, Convener. Witnesses have spoken about engagement around Scottish Government and the transfer from PIP and DLA and to DP. And so can I ask the panel what their understanding is of the policy, particularly for those over pension age? And I'll maybe bring in Richard first on that.
Richard Gass, please.
Yeah, yes, thank you. The group that I participate in, this is a regular question I raise, is about the folk on DLA and what's going to happen to them. And while we've not had anything concrete, the words that come back are that people are not expecting the current DLA receipt, which is the answer I like to hear, but I prefer to see that in some sort of written policy format, or better still, in some legislative format.
Thanks,
Richard. Miles.
Is there anyone else that is coming on that point now? One of the concerns which I know the committee has had put to us is about people moving around the UK and having that seamless system in place. For roles which will be different in different parts of the United Kingdom. So I just wondered if members of the panel feel that currently the systems are adequate enough to capture that so that people don't fall through the net when they're moving around different systems and structures. Again, maybe I'll bring in Richard, and then if the other panel members have anything they want to add, then they put an R in the chat.
Thanks, Miles. Richard Gass.
Yeah, thank you. I can't say I know the answer to that one. I know the ambition is that it would be seamless, but that's going to rely on engagement with DWP and for folk to folk need to notify changes of circumstances, and sometimes there's a slowness in that process. So there's Social Security Scotland, there's DWP, there's the claimant themselves. Sometimes moves may happen which aren't anticipated to be permanent but become permanent. For example, someone comes up to care for another relative who themselves are disabled but don't expect to stay. If they end up staying, then it's at what point does some physically at an address does not mean that you have moved. There needs to be a consideration, well, this is now my new address. But I think it's a complicated area, and I'm probably waffling now, so I'll just stop.
Not at all. Not at all. Ed Pybus, please.
Yes, so I think it does have to be seamless. I think I was just trying to check on the rules, but there are rules about if you move from Scotland to the UK, what happens to your adult, your Scottish adult disability payments. The converse rules for when you move to Scotland and how long your PIP continues before you have to claim will be a matter for DWP, but it needs to be seamless. I guess one, there's a couple of little technical points. One, for example, it doesn't seem to be clear what happens if you claim PIP and then move to Scotland. So that's something that could potentially be sorted out. And I guess the broader thing is we would like an approach where it's kind of no wrong door, as it's called. But if anyone in any part applies for a disability benefit, it's between Social Security Scotland and the DWP to work out who should be paying it and what. It shouldn't be the case that someone gets told, oh, sorry, you should have applied for a benefit in Scotland, or you should have applied for a benefit in England or Wales. So some kind of agreement, departmental level agreement, would be useful around that.
Thanks, Ed. Judith Patterson, please.
I think it's right to identify this confusion in the future. It's brand new, not had to deal with this before. There are no clear lines for people or for decision makers to follow when people are moving from one part of the country to another. For example, there's no rule that says if you're out of the country for a certain length of time, then after that you'll be deemed to have moved to a matter of judgment. And then, of course, there's the extra complexity of a handover of agency. So all of that means that things will go wrong. So it will. I think the important thing is to be alert to that and make sure that's not under the radar, so that both agencies are monitoring, seeing where things are going wrong and trying to improve their systems. It's more likely to be a system improvement rather than a regulation improvement, though, I would say.
Thanks, Judith. Before I bring in Emma Roddick, just checking, Miles, have you got a further question?
Please, convener. Yeah, I just, one of the areas which the committee have also received quite substantial evidence is around people receiving PIP with mental health issues. So I wondered specifically whether or not you think the system has captured that as we look towards moving from PIP to ADP, and whether or not there's any examples of that work kind of being captured. It's maybe a question to put Judith, as I know you've been kind of looking at a lot of this specifically.
Thanks, Miles. Judith.
Thanks.
You're quite right. People with mental health issues form a very, very large proportion of people who are claiming PIP. So it's vital the system works for them. And in a sense, every aspect of the system has to be considered in terms of mental health. So it's not just the regulations. One of the things that SCOS did see in the regulations, this is actually maybe drilling in to a smaller point at the beginning, but it was actually about terminology. So the regulations were actually rather ambiguous and unclear about whether they were referring to somebody with a mental health condition, for example, a psychiatric condition, or whether it was learning disabilities or a cognitive disorder. So we did recommend that there was further consultation to get that terminology right, not just in the regulations, but in how it's communicated with people. And that the medical professionals who are taken on to for decision makers to get specialist advice on must have relevant experience. So that's improvement that people wanted to see, and SCOS was pleased about that as well. Other issues to do with suspensions, for example, the committee will know that during a review of people's entitlement, if people don't respond to requests for information, there is a potential for an award to be suspended. And of course, that very engagement is something that people with mental ill health might find more difficult. So we'd be looking to see what safeguarding measures are put in place to make sure that people don't fall out the system just on the grounds of the of their disability.
Thanks, Judith. Emma Roddick, please.
Thanks, Convener, and hello everyone. I notice here there's concerns raised around those who are above pension age and how they might be affected in moving to ADP, and there's maybe a theme emerging there around different age benefits and the issues that come with transferring. So could I ask Ed and Judith, do you believe that differently aged disabled people should have different eligibility criteria or different benefits, and should that be something that is looked at a UK level?
Ed Pybus, please.
I guess we don't have a view on the correct way of doing that, whether it should be a single benefit for all ages or different benefits at different ages. But as you've discussed, this is the model we have, and the transfer, and we need to make sure that the rules cover all of those possibilities. So you've got, you know, most people on PIP will be working age, most people of pension age will be getting attendance allowance, but we know that, for example, there's some people who are getting DLA who are working age, or DLA who are pension age, or there's people who will have PIP and move to pension age. So we need to make sure that the rules around those transfers are absolutely robust. And so, again, no one falls through the cracks. The majority of people, that will be fine, but there will be quite a huge number of people who don't fit the standard model. And we need to make sure that both the regulations support that, and the processes support it. And I think it's worth reiterating the point Judith made there as well, is that at those points, people don't fall through the cracks, but people are supported. And if someone doesn't respond to a request for information or some information about a transfer, they're supported to do that, as opposed to the claim kind of just falling away.
Thanks, Ed. Judith Patterson, please.
SCOS hasn't taken a view on whether there should be a lifelong benefit either, so I can't really say. And neither did we have in scope for scrutiny the case transfer regulations, so we literally haven't seen those. So we don't know how people over pension age would be transferred onto adult disability payment. But yes, quite right, there are issues as children, young people transfer into adult benefits, and there are differences between working age and pension age benefits. I suppose, helpfully, if you're already on benefit before pension age, then you stay on the same benefits. You're not obliged to make a fresh claim reaching pension age. So that's a better feature of the system.
Thank you, Judith. In the final section around future-proofing, we're looking for Pam Duncan-Glancy, please, followed by Evelyn Tweed. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks again for all your contributions. It's been really interesting this morning. Given the number of issues that we've discussed and that hopefully there is ambition to change a lot about adult disability payments so that disabled people have the support they need to lead an ordinary life, do the panel have a view on whether there is sufficient systems in place within the current social security system in Scotland to support continuous improvement, specifically given since Social Security Scotland's approach is to have a minimum viable product? And maybe I could pose that to Judith, if that's okay. Thanks.
Judith Patterson, please.
SCOS has begun engagement with Social Security Scotland to begin to understand those issues. I think it's absolutely right to early on look at continuous improvement. SCOS statutory role in terms of the charter, and one of the first things we might well look at is that very issue, continuous improvement, and whether the systems are in place to be able to monitor all the most important things that need to be monitored. I'm not sure I've got more to say at this point on that, although there were some areas in terms of process that SCoS identified that should be an early focus for that, for those kinds of things. And that was the things where it's kind of critical that it's got right to make sure that people get the right decision at the right early on and don't have to go to appeal. So it's things, new things to the system, like how applications are made, how people are supported, and how supporting information is gathered, that we thought should be an early focus for that monitoring and continual improvement, because that's critical to people getting money in their pocket at the right time.
Thanks very much for that, Judith. Do you have another question there, Pam, before I bring in Evelyn? Thank you very much. Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thank you. And thanks for all your information so far. It's been really helpful. To what extent might options for the independent review be constrained because of the way devolved and reserved benefits interact? And how should this problem be addressed? And could I pose that to Judith, please?
Judith Patterson.
Yeah, I mean, one of the main constraints is the issue of passporting. So, for example, Northern Ireland has its own social security powers, but they've chosen to be in complete lockstep with the UK. Scotland doesn't have that lockstep process. So as soon as the UK diverges and Scotland doesn't, or as soon as Scotland begins to make changes and the UK doesn't, this could be a real issue that needs to be resolved. Of course, as I understand, Scottish Government has been discussing with DWP the entire time to make sure that the changes that were proposed would still be regarded as like for like and wouldn't impact on passporting entitlements. But I don't think anything can be taken for granted for the future. In terms of how that can be resolved, I think there could be all kinds of options on the table about resolving it. And I suppose the most radical option would be actually making sure that all the passporting benefits were actually within the control of the Scottish Government. But we're nowhere near that at the moment, so that's not a kind of medium-term solution.
Thanks, Judith. Evelyn, do you have a further question?
No, that's me for now, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Indeed, that's very helpful. I wanted, just before we wrap up, to ask a couple of final questions. First of all, touching on the theme that Evelyn just raised there around passporting and around the interchangeability of the devolved and reserved systems. I note that SCoS have highlighted their concern around the UK government's green paper on health and disability, and that it could have significant implications, quote, for the devolved system. Judith, could you please elaborate where your concerns lie there in terms of the green paper and potential white paper coming early next year?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously a very early stages, so it's hard to talk in specific terms. But the Green Paper does refer to consulting on changing PIP descriptors. So subject to the timing of any changes to descriptors in PIP, then there are obvious implications for the Scottish system. The committee has explored today the safe and secure transition and the consequences of making early changes to descriptors. That could happen at the UK level and be taken out of the hands of the Scottish Government. So that's something that needs to be kept under close scrutiny. In the longer term, there's really radical changes suggested, so exploring the scope of actually combining working age benefits like universal credit allowance and PIP into one benefit. So that would be combining what is a UK benefit with what is a devolved benefit, and it's very hard to see how that could work in Scotland where one benefits in the control of one government and one in control of another. That's, there've been numerous policy challenges, delivery challenges with all of that. And all of which could raise questions about the passporting arrangements as well. So that kind of significant restructuring in the Green Paper, although the Green Paper says we're at reverse to PIP, that's not, that wouldn't apply in Scotland. That might be true directly, but there could be all kinds of indirect consequences that would apply in Scotland.
Thanks very much. Ed Pybus, before I move to my final question.
One other more immediate issue that potentially comes up is combining assessments for out of work benefits like Universal Credit or ESA and PIP. And if a claimant in the UK, in the rest of the UK, is having one assessment for both benefits, what does that mean for the Scottish system? Would someone have to have two assessments, one for their ADP and one for their ESA or Universal Credit? Or would there be a way of sharing that information? And there's easy ways to get around that. There can be solutions and sharing of information, but it needs to be, again, agreements between DWP and Social Security Scotland.
Judith Patterson, very briefly.
Thanks. Yeah, there was just one really significant consequence that I meant to mention, which is the cost implications of divergence as well. So the Green Paper throughout talks about at cost, and that's the context for those changes. So if there's a reduced cost of delivering PIP in the UK, then there could be, through the fiscal framework, less money for the Scottish Government to deliver adult disability payment. So that's a major implication for Scotland.
Thank you very much indeed. Conscious as I am of time, my final question is an area that we haven't covered as yet, and it's for first of all, for Richard Gass, and it's around the issue about short-term assistance. The Scottish Fiscal Commission has made an assumption with many caveats, as we said, around as many as 90% of people in receipt of ADP could be accessing short-term assistance. Is that assuming that the changed assessment process in Scotland will continue to make the same award mistakes as the DWP makes with PIP? Richard, do you share those concerns?
It comes from all I can talk about is my understanding of kind of claimant's attitude to benefit. I'd maybe break it down into three scenarios here. Someone who's today receiving a benefit and then tomorrow there's an assessment to say you're no longer entitled to that. Most folk don't like that, so they will appeal that decision if they feel comforted to do so. If they get short-term assistance over the process, good and well. There'll then be some people, and I would say very few folk, who are quite content with the decision to reduce their benefit. I don't imagine there'll be too many of them that would then say, well, actually, I'll engage in appeals process so I can artificially get some short-term assistance prior to the appeal. I don't think they are of significance. I think what is of significance is there'll be some people who today get turned down for a benefit but don't have confidence or trust that the process of challenge will achieve anything. They'll feel that they're on trial for their disability and they just don't want to engage with that. However, if short-term assistance is available pending the appeal process, then that might persuade them that, well, there is value in pursuing an appeal, certainly in the short term and perhaps in the longer term. And I don't think that encouraging folk to take up their rights is a bad thing. But I can't comment on where 90% is or if it's realistic.
Thanks. Ed Pybus, finally, please.
That's all which is covered and nothing to add.
Lovely. Thank you very much indeed. I really appreciate all of your time this morning. To Ed Pybus, Richard Gass and Judith Patterson, your input has been invaluable as we go through the process of scrutinising the implementation of ADP. Really greatly appreciated. No doubt that we'll be back in touch again, but in the meantime, I wish you all a Merry Christmas. And I would like now to suspend briefly in order to change over the panel of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed for bearing with us while we switch over. I'm very pleased to for us to be joined now by our second panel of witnesses. Joining us this morning are Craig Smith, Senior Policy and Research Officer for the Scottish Association for Mental Health, Frank McCulloch, Head of Policy and Research at Enable Scotland, Keith Park, Policy, Public Affairs and Campaigns Manager at the MS Society Scotland, Tricia Hatt, Macmillan Strategic Partnership Manager, and Bill Scott, who is the Senior Policy Advisor at Inclusion Scotland. Welcome to you all. Your presence is very, we're very grateful for your presence this morning. But turn immediately to questions, and first question this morning is from Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Davina, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for coming and to join us. I suppose I'd like to open with an opening question. Many of you have been on this journey, watching these regulations and watching employment legislation going through over the last 5 years. And I suppose one of the concerns I have is that we haven't seen enough changes around this, particularly around variable conditions and the higher rate of mobility. And I just wonder whether you could comment on if we could make changes around variability and around mobility, what difference would that make to the people that you are seeking to represent? And maybe we could start with Keith for that one.
Keith Park, followed by Bill Scott, please. Keith.
Sorry. Thank you to the committee for inviting us to speak today. We very much welcome the opportunity. When DLA changed to PIP, a third of people with MS lost out on their enhanced rate of mobility component. So that's approximately 3,000 people across the UK lost out on that higher rate of mobility payment, which has a huge impact on people's abilities to live their lives. That has a huge impact as well because it affects the availability of mobility vehicles, etc. And as part of that process, people with MS have had to give up their work and not be able to stay in employment, which, as we all know, is a human right, and it affects their position in life, it affects their position in society and how much they're contributing. So by maintaining the 20 metre rule, it's having a huge impact on people's life. How far does 20 metres actually get you? In most cases, it doesn't actually allow people to leave their house and their garden. It doesn't get them to their nearest bus stop. So it's a huge impact on people, and that's a huge, huge detrimental effect on how people are able to live their lives. So for people with MS, it's been the biggest aspect of the regulations that they've wanted to change, and we've been pushing for this since PIP was proposed by the DWP and Westminster government, because it is very much the issue that's at the heart of the people with MS and impacts them the most.
Thanks, Keith. Bill Scott, please.
I'd just repeat what Keith has said. The evidence from cases across the UK is that when people transfer from DLA to PIP who are on higher rate mobility on DLA, approximately 50% of them lose entitlement to the enhanced rate of mobility component of PIP. So, you know, 50%, half the people who were previously on the higher rate have lost it. And that has a devastating impact on their lives. As Keith said, it could impact on their ability to be in employment, but also impacts on the ability to see friends and family, to take part in aspects of community life, and to access essential services like health and education. And this shouldn't be underestimated, that it increases the isolation that disabled people face, and it increases it quite massively. And Scotland is a much more rural country than England. In the central belt, yes, there are good accessible transport systems in certain cities. Out with the central belt, there are large areas of Scotland that are very rural, where there's large distances to negotiate to access retail, shops and services. And if you haven't got a car, if you haven't got a mobility vehicle, and you lose that with when you lose your higher rate mobility, then you just can't get there any longer. So we've seen that you know, people really struggling to access hospital services in the Highlands and the Borders and Dumfries and Galloway, etc. So yeah, it's one of the aspects of PIP that we really wanted to see tackled when we had a devolved benefit system.
Thanks, Bill. Keith, you're looking to come back in briefly?
Yes, thank you, Convener. The other thing that I meant to add was the fact that there's no evidence base to 20 metres being the measurement of how somebody's mobility needs are. And indeed, that was acknowledged by the Scottish Government in terms of their consultation on the regulations when they said that changing the 20 metre rule, 50% rule in isolation, could further embed unfairness in the system. So if our starting point is acknowledging that that's an unfair measurement of somebody's mobility, then to not have changed that and not to have moved on from that doesn't seem as if it fits with the principles of dignity, fairness and respect.
Thanks, Keith. Jeremy, do you have a further question there?
Yes, yeah, just a couple more quick questions to follow on. In the first panel, the issue came up of those who are present on DLA, and when we transfer across, will come off DLA and come on to PIP. And this may affect not only mobility, but in regard to those with variable conditions, may mean that they actually lose the benefit. Do you know from any kind of talking to your members how many people this would affect, and is it a concern that you have? And I have one more question after that, Kamina. And maybe, I don't know whether either Bill or Keith have information on that or others.
Any colleagues in the virtual room with any information or input that they would like to make regarding that question? Keith Park.
We don't have exact figures in terms of how many people that will affect in Scotland. I'll just go back to what I said in my previous answer, that a third of people with MS have had that level of support reduced. And in fact, 1 in 10 people with MS, when they were moved from DLA to PIP, actually lost out completely on their mobility. So to give an answer for what impact that will have going forward, I can't actually answer that other than to refer to where we're at just now. Across the UK, though, we estimated that between 2020 and 2022, there would be 611 people with MS that would actually leave work and leave employment as a result of those changes. And again, we think that will be something that will be the same and mirrored moving forward.
Bill Scott.
The Scottish Government itself did an estimate of how many people would lose out because of the move from the 50-metre rule to the 20-metre rule. And their estimate was between 15 and 16,000 Scots, disabled people, would lose entitlement to the higher rate, enhanced rate of PIP on transfer from DLA. And the same will, you know, effectively, it will be the same number of people affected overall with the transfer, either between DLA to ADP or from PIP, where they've already lost out to ADP. They're not going to get it back, in other words, at the moment. So approximately between 15 and 16,000. And Keith's absolutely right. I mean, people with variable conditions like MS, also those with energy limiting impairments like ME, who have difficulty walking some days but not others, and people with mental health issues and learning difficulties have all lost out in terms of the higher rate. Because of the descriptors used, it's not just the 50-metre rule. There's issues around the descriptors about being able to make a journey safely that make things more difficult for people with mental health issues in getting the enhanced rate of mobility on PIP.
Thank you. Craig Smith, please.
Hi, and thank you very much for having me. Yeah, just a quick point on the variability, and I don't have any kind of numbers about the change from DLA to PIP and how many people that's affected, but kind of following on from Bill's point around, and going back to the 50% rule, so not the 50-metre rule, but the 50% rule overall for PIP and getting awards against the activities and descriptors, that's been a real challenge and our long one of our longest running kind of issues with PIP, and we recognise why it's been maintained, the 50% rule in ADP. We really hope to see in the longer term that to be explored further and hopefully changed. But that's been really difficult for people with fluctuating conditions, so particularly people with mental health problems, who under the legislation have to demonstrate that their conditions are impacting them 50% of a month. And that can be very difficult if you have bipolar or you have schizophrenia or any other mental health problem, which may fluctuate rapidly over long periods of time, or you may have short periods of real distress followed by long periods of stability, and people can fall out of the system due to that, both in terms of daily living component, but particularly as well the mobility component too. And we have some ongoing concerns around the mobility descriptors, and it's very difficult if you have a mental health problem to, as kind of Bill alluded to get points under the mobility activities and descriptors under PIP. So while we recognise the rationale for retaining the current PIP descriptors, more broadly retaining them under ADP, it is a real challenge going forward. And we hope some of the process issues around how consultations are carried out, the kind of burden of proof against the descriptors, may improve that situation, but we do really need to see in the longer term fundamental changes to the structure of the benefits, including the descriptors and the 50% rule, which does make it very difficult for people with fluctuating conditions to be confident that they will get the support that they deserve under the system.
Thanks, Craig. Final question, Jeremy, before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, very briefly, In your opinion, do you think it is possible that we could transfer safely and make changes at the same time? And if that's not possible, do you think it's possible to make any changes that will come forward out of the independent review within this Parliament? Or are we realistically looking to the next Parliament? And maybe start with Bill on that one.
Bill Scott.
Thanks for handing me the hand grenade, Jeremy. I think it could be difficult to make the changes after the independent review within the lifetime of this Parliament, simply because they will have to be consulted on, the regulations will then have to be redrafted, go through the consultation process with SCOS, and then come back to Parliament to be voted on, and then they will have to be introduced, implemented by the new agency, and your guidance will have to be drawn up, etc. That this is all quite a lengthy process, as we've seen already, in arriving at where we are today. It's taken essentially 5 years since the legislation was devolved to Scotland to get to the stage where we're considering the regulations for the new benefit. Now, new systems had to be established, staff had to be recruited, new computer systems had to be set up. I'm not having a go at the lengthy time it's taken, but it has to be acknowledged that these things do not happen overnight. And that is a real worry, because I think that when we first consulted with disabled people back in 2016 and 17 on the devolved benefits, actually the emphasis was on a safe and secure transfer, but I think if they'd known how long it was going to take to look at the entitlement criteria, I'm not so sure that we would our members would have been so supportive of that. Sorry for taking up a wee bit of time.
No problem. Thanks, Bill. I'll take Frank McKillop, followed by Craig Smith and Keith Park.
Thanks, Convener. I think from our view at Enable Scotland, and again, thank you for inviting us to give evidence today, we feel there's some minor tweaks that can be made to the eligibility criteria. And I think the view in that is widening access to it. So I understand the point that the Cabinet Secretary made in the letter last month to Pam Duncan-Glancy, that the objective behind safe and secure transfers to ensure effectively no detriment to claimants. Our view is that if you are implementing minor tweaks that would potentially broaden access to these benefits and ensure that no one is unfairly denied a benefit that is reflective of their circumstances, there should be no detriment to anyone who's currently accessing that benefit. And so that's sort of minor adjustments at this time we feel is possible within the safe and secure transfer. And again, would agree with Bill's point that I think the prospect that if we don't make changes now when we're undertaking this fairly substantial process, there might be a long time before we're able to make those changes. So I think there are some immediate positive changes that could be implemented quickly. And in our view, that can be done within the principle of safe and secure transfer and would not put anyone's benefit entitlements at risk.
Thank you. Craig Smith, please.
Yeah, absolutely agree with the last comments, both from Bill and Frank. I think our big concern about future changes and the speed of those changes is in large part comes down to the issue of passporting. So we as an organisation agreed with the Scottish Government's rationale around safe and secure transfer for the reasons they set out about not wanting to create a two-tier system at the start of the process and to ensure that passport benefits were protected. That can have a huge policy constraint going forward if the issue of passporting is not sorted out. So there needs to be, either through the independent review and through agreements between both governments, real clarity about what is the scope for future change, because the issue of passporting and a like-for-like benefit isn't going to change at any point in the process, irrespective of case transfer. If that issue is still going to be there, that there needs to be an agreement that ADP is equivalent to PIP or any replacement benefit down south after the Green Paper, that issue needs to be really bottomed out to get into scope what is at play in terms of what are the changes that could be made while still protecting passport benefits. We obviously don't want to see anyone lose passport benefits and lose financial support, which is absolutely key to people's lives and independent living. But we need to get to a point where we can see what is the scope of changes that can happen, because having an indefinite restraint on policy in Scotland due to the passporting issue is not really acceptable in the long term, and needs to be clarity between both governments about that, so that we can in the longer term consider fundamental changes to ADP, such as a move away from a points-based system or a move away from the 50% rule. But if the issue of passporting benefits is always going to be there in terms of needing a like-for-like benefit, then that's a real restraint kind of indefinitely. So we need to see some clarity on that.
Thanks, Craig. Keith Park, please.
Thank you. I agree with everything that's been said so far, in that the concern is about passported benefits in a two-tier system, no matter when the review takes place and when the changes are proposed, we're going to be in the same position. DWP will have their credit eligibility criteria still in place for PIP, and that may have changed in the meantime from where we are at just now in terms of the ADP regulations. So we're just pushing the can down the road, so to speak, and delaying that, having those conversations in terms of making those changes. If you look at the timescale from in terms of when the consultation opened to where we're at now, that's a full year that's taken place around the regulations for ADP to be rolled out. The independent review will be gathering data and information. To do that effectively, that's going to take an awful long time and potentially up to a year. So if that starts in 2023, the summer of 2023, you're talking 2 years. So I don't think we'll be in a position to be able to roll that out in terms of this Parliament, to answer Jeremy's initial question. In terms of, are we able to make some of those changes now? We believe so. The political and the policy will is there. There's a broad consensus across the Chamber and at Holyrood that the 20-metre rule, for example, and the eligibility criteria around that isn't fair, and it's something that we should be looked at. So if the issue is a technical one, I think it's something that the two governments, and Scottish Government, Social Security Scotland and the DWP, can discuss and come to an agreement to, and as again, I think it was Craig that said, ensure that those agreements are in place and we can move forward, because without having those conversations and without having that agreement in place, we're going to be in a very similar position come whenever the review publishes its advice and recommendations and then trying to implement those changes.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. I was just waiting until the camera came on there. Thanks very much, and thanks again to the panel for your evidence. It's incredibly powerful actually to hear the impact of some of the eligibility criteria that still exist and disability benefits on the people that you represent. And I have to say, picking up on Bill's point about safe and secure, as someone who declaring an interest here who gets personal independence payment, I too would of course be really concerned if I thought that for 1 minute in the process of transferring from one government agency to another, the benefit stopped and I lost my mobility vehicle, for example. So it's no wonder that disabled people have said safely and securely transferring is important. But I must admit, I also think that if they were told it was going to come at the cost of possibly 10 years before there actually would be any fundamental change to the benefit, I agree, I don't think they would have put that first. So I'll move to my question. Before I do, one of the things I think is really important, it was the First Minister actually put the impact of the PIP criteria very, very well when she said that people who get enhanced mobility support could lose up to £3,000 a year. Important though that money is, let us remember that for people in those circumstances, that loss could take away more than pounds and pence. It could take away their independence. And I wholeheartedly agree with her, which is why I think we need to move on this. So my question to the panel, and probably specifically to Keith, Bill and Craig, is that in the coming weeks, months and years, can you set out a rough figure of the number of people who are going to be left without their independence as a result of the continuing criteria the way it is? And do you think there is any reason why the Scottish Government couldn't start to review eligibility and adequacy now, so that when Safe and Secure finished on in 2023, if it indeed does, we can switch on the new system that day almost?
Mark, please, I think you were mentioned first. Keith.
Sorry, I was just waiting for my microphone to come on, convener. As I said to one of my earlier answers, we believe that 611 people across the UK will leave employment as a result of losing the mobility component and their enhanced mobility component. Roughly, that would be, I would say, around about 70 people in Scotland if you calculate what the population, the MS population, is in Scotland. And we hear this regularly from people that we've been speaking to throughout the consultation process, the fact that they're now having to claim additional benefits as a result of losing their mobility vehicle. They've had to give up their work, as I've said, but also they're almost becoming a recluse. And as Bill said earlier as well, that social isolation is a huge issue for people with MS generally. And that's something that we're perpetuating to some extent by continuing with a measure that says that if you can't walk 20 metres, that you don't deserve to have that enhanced rate of mobility and allow you to have that mobility vehicle. I would agree that I think that if we're not willing to change the eligibility criteria now, then that work should start. I think in terms of our position as an organisation, we very much are pushing for a return to the 50 metres being the measurement that's used. Again, this is an arbitrary measure and is not ideal because ultimately if you can walk 51 metres, what difference is that to walking 49 metres? It's not that far. We need to have a whole-scale review of eligibility criteria that measures mobility holistically and doesn't rely on an arbitrary figure that looks at somebody's ability to walk on a flat, level surface. I don't know what the panel's experience is, but there's very few roads around about where I live that are actually flat and level, which means that it puts more pressure on people who have balance issues, who have issues with fatigue and concentration as a result of their fatigue. So we really have to look at mobility criteria in the whole and assess what we need, that how that can be measured somebody holistically. And to do that, we need to make sure that we have policy involvement with that, we've got healthcare professionals involved in that process, but most importantly, we're actually involving people with disabilities and conditions such as MS and others to make sure that we're measuring mobility effectively.
Thanks, Keith. I'll bring in Bill, followed by Craig, as mentioned by Pam, but I'm conscious of the fact that we haven't heard from Tricia Hatt yet, and if Tricia has anything to add, I'd be happy to bring her in after that. Bill, please.
Obviously, I agree with everything Keith has just said. Just to go back to one of the issues, though, and it is related, it's on passporting. A lot of the passported benefits you get access to are reserved. In the case of the mobility component, most of the passported benefits are actually devolved. For example, automatic entitlement to Blue Badge Scheme. And in terms of the mobility, motability is self-financing. As soon as somebody's on the higher rate or enhanced rate of the mobility component, they can afford the motability vehicle, and the leasing pays for itself. And in fact, motability come out several hundred million pounds a year in profit, which is then donated back to the motability charity. So, you know, I don't think there is big barriers over the 50 metre and 20 metre rule as there might be, unfortunately, around the 50% rule. So I think there could be more done in the nearer future. I think the biggest barrier to it is cost. And I think that came through in the Scottish Government's policy paper on this, that there are costs associated with this. It was mentioned in the last session that the UK government wanted to save 20% of the DLA bill, and partially they were going to achieve that through the change to the 50 metre rule and bringing it down to 20 metres. In fact, they've only made 5% of savings, but virtually all of those savings have come from people losing the higher rate of motability when moving from DLA to PIP. So, you know, there are cost implications, and those should be considered, how we're going to fund that, et cetera, in the future. But as I say, I don't think there's big a barrier in terms of passporting.
Thanks, Bill. Craig Smith, followed by Tricia Hatt, please.
Yeah, I think Pam goes to your point about when we should start looking at changes. I think that should start immediately. Obviously, we have the commitment to the independent review, which is absolutely key, and we want to see that being truly independent and being led by people with disability and lived experience of the social security system. But I don't think that should be a barrier for the government and wider stakeholders looking at changes to the eligibility criteria now, because we know what the key issues are. It's been brought up numerous times from across the disability sector since the journey of devolution of Social Security Scotland happened, things like the 50% rule, things like the descriptors. So we do know what the key issues are, and there should be ongoing evaluation of them and a way to change that, which can feed into the independent review, but shouldn't necessarily have to wait till the independent review gets its work underway. We believe there should be kind of minor changes, for example, to the eligibility criteria in the daily living. Under some of the descriptors, we'd like more explicit reference to psychological distress. For example, under preparing food and taking nutrition, to highlight the experiences of people with eating disorders and the psychological distress associated with preparing food, which isn't easily captured under the current descriptors. And we think they're fairly minor changes, which we argue could happen now. There may be a counter argument that may again be changed too far in terms of a like-for-like benefit. I think we'd argue minor changes to descriptors wouldn't fall under that. But yeah, back to the timing point, I think work needs to be done now before the independent review around terms of references for that. But just ongoing work from the Scottish Government, the Social Security Agency, the Commission and the wider sector, because as I say, we know what key concerns are and key structural concerns are with the benefits such as the 50% rule and the descriptors and point-based system.
Thanks, Craig. Tricia Hatt, please, followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy for a follow-up.
Yeah, good morning, everyone, and thank you, convener, for bringing me in. I think I would agree with everything so far that the panel have said. I think from a cancer population, supporting people with a cancer diagnosis, often they have not accessed any benefits. They may have been working. So I think it's really important that we make sure that this new system is done in a timely manner, that again, that the review is undertaken as a quarterly review, and the government are able to review this and again just look at the targets that are being hit for people. Are they being hit? Are people getting access to it? All that information from people themselves, how was the system for them? Could they access it? We've got long history of supporting people with benefits claims, particularly now through the Improving Cancer Journey. And these link workers, these support staff, benefits advisors are very skilled at supporting people to get access. So we need not for that to change in any way.
Thanks, Tricia. Very conscious of time. We've got probably just under half an hour left and quite a few colleagues to get through. So if we could be quick with questions and answers, and if you have, if colleagues on the panel have anything to add, it'd be helpful if they could come in, please, rather than reiterations. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you. I just finally wanted to pick up on the point in Sam H's submission around the fact that there was an intention for people who were on PIP, if they were being reviewed during this period, to be reviewed in the ADP system, and that that has been delayed, as we know. Can you talk a little bit about the impact that's had on the people you represent, and perhaps, Bill, if you have any further evidence on that particular issue as well, that would be really helpful to hear. Thanks.
Bill Scott.
I have no evidence on that I can offer, unfortunately. We've had limited contact with disabled people, unfortunately, all online since the pandemic started. So we've not asked them that particular question, but I'm sure there are people out there. I'm sure other people can answer the question better.
I can see Craig Smith is looking to come in there.
Yeah, so Pam, as you correctly say, we mentioned this in our submission to the committee. So our concern was around that delay to the implementation of ADP, which we absolutely understand and we accept that the pandemic happened and is happening as we're all sitting in our rooms at the moment. So that delayed implementation made sense. Our concern was for that cohort of people who would have transferred this year in 2021. And we know that the very welcome commitment was people transferring when their PIP claims came up for review, would then transfer to ADP without having to make an application, without being assessed, which we very much welcomed. So our concern was that for that cohort for this year, whose claims come up for review in PIP, will now have to go through a PIP reassessment, possibly a face-to-face assessment, and possibly a long wait, depending how long the reward is, before their case transferred to ADP once ADP does come online next year. So that's a really big impact for people with mental health problems, because we know the distress caused by, for example, the face-to-face assessment for PIP and the real stigmatising issues that come up in that, and the general real distress and impact on people's mental health about going through that process. So we highlighted that with the government when the delay was announced, again reiterating that we understood about the delay and called for a kind of rapid case transfer for people who went through the PIP system this year, who were promised that they would be in ADP, and through no fault of their own with the pandemic, that's been delayed. So we definitely would like to see the government looking at that when they come to case transfer around people both who were awarded PIP this year once the award came up for review, but also people who lost out on a PIP claim this year, and so they're not lost in the system. So we think there should be some really proactive engagement with the Scottish Government, with the third sector, and with awareness campaigns around people's right to apply for ADP, even if they have made past applications that maybe they didn't get an award for PIP, possibly this year or previously, when ADP does come online next year, just so that cohort who would have avoided a face-to-face assessment under if the timescale was kept to this year, who may have faced that through PIP through this year just because of the delay. So we'd like to see some proactive work from the government just to identify that group of people, which we think are quite significant group of people, and invite them to transfer to ADP as soon as possible.
Thank you, Craig. Marie McNair, please, followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. To aid our understanding of the 20-metre rule, same question that I asked our first panel. This was introduced by the Tory government at Westminster. What was the rationale for introducing it? Was there any assessment of its impact? Is there any suggestion they will move away from it, given the condemnation of the policy? I'm going to put that to Bill and Keith. I know, Bill, you've kind of spoken about that already, but if you could expand a bit more, that'd be really helpful. Thank you.
Bill, please.
Yeah. At the time that the welfare reforms were being introduced, it was identified by the then UK government that the cost of disability benefits were rising, and in particular that people were gaining access to the mobility component of DLA and carrying it into their pension years. This is possible. You know, if you apply to PIP, DLA, or EDP, and you're entitled to higher rate mobility, you carry that through into your retirement years. So the intention was not just to reduce the spend on working age disability benefits, but also on disability benefits in retirement. And you can make long-term savings that way. And because you could be affecting somebody's entitlement to a motability vehicle for 30 or 40 years you know, quite easily by removing that entitlement, by reducing the length of the test, whether you can work, whether you can walk 50 metres down to 20 metres. And at the time, every single disability organisation in the UK, both charities and organisations of disabled people, opposed the move and said it would result in unfairness. And the UK government, in its response to the consultation on the change, stated that they were going to go ahead with it because they knew that it would result in benefit savings. So there is only one reason for it, and that is because it would reduce the number of people who were entitled and reduce their entitlement, not only when during the working age part of their lives, but also into their retirement. So it has a long-term impact on, as I say, £3,000 a year, but also on people's ability to get about for the rest of their lives.
Thanks very much, Bill. Conscious with two UK-wide organisations present, Keith and Tricia, have you any view as to whether or not, in terms of Marie's final part of her question there, whether the UK government has any intention to review the 20-metre rule? Because clearly that would answer some of the problems that have been requested here in terms of the concerns on passporting and in terms of the concerns around the move for those from DLA that are currently on DLA moving to ADP. Tricia first, then Keith.
Being a UK-wide organisation, I would hope that my other colleagues in other countries would listen. We are very much in contact with them, particularly after this review today, our discussion today, and I will update them. So I would hope that there would be some sort of influence that we could bring about to my colleagues down in England and Wales. So yes, I would hope so.
Thank you, Tricia. Keith Park, please.
Similar to Tricia, it's UK colleagues that have been working and leading on that. Obviously, the Green Paper and the White Paper have been published, and I don't know the ins and outs of that, I'm afraid, so I can't say for certain if it is something that's been considered. I don't believe it is, but I say I couldn't say that with any certainty. But again, similar to Tricia, we're working very closely with our colleagues to highlight the benefits that have been, that will, should be, come through in terms of where we're at now with ADP, but also pushing to come back on where we should go in the future. I can make sure that our colleagues from London pass on information. We can share that with the committee afterwards. I'd also like to just again say that I completely agree with everything that Bill had said around the reasoning behind changing the distance from 50 metres to 20 metres. One of the things that we've been pushing on at a UK level throughout the time of 2013 pretty much is asking the UK government to provide evidence as to why they've used that measure, and there is no evidence base to it. As I said, there is no basis that it highlights that somebody that can walk 21 metres has more need, or less need, sorry, for mobility support than somebody that can walk 19 metres. So again, it's not based on any evidence, and therefore it's very, very much an unfair criteria to measure somebody's ability to mobilise.
Thank you very much indeed, Keith. Marie, do you have a further question?
Yes, I have.
Before I bring in Faisal.
Marie. We want to encourage claims for ADP. Although it's early days, are the panel aware of any lessons we can learn from the initial implementation of the child disability payment? And I'll pop that to Frank.
Frank McKillop, please.
Yeah, I think it's certainly what's been a big advantage with the Child Disability Payments has been the publicity campaign. I think both originating with Social Security Scotland and also through organisations such as our own and other charities that support families with children. I think raising that awareness, there's sometimes an advantage to just the fact it's something different, in particular, I think, related to maybe negative experiences that families have had in the past in terms of applying for benefits. So I think there's certainly an opportunity there in terms of broadening applications and perhaps building on perhaps poor experiences people have had where they've been they've had bad experiences at assessment for PIP and are perhaps feeling that they were unfairly denied access to a benefit they should have been entitled to. I think that's probably a major lesson that can be learned there, just to ensure we are activating and supporting the third sector to reach out to people that they support and people that they work with to ensure that people who should be entitled to these benefits are actually able to come forward and encouraged to come forward and supported and given access to advocacy that they might require when they do come forward. And I think that's a critical part of it, that we are supporting the sector to support people who need these benefits and will be able to access them.
Thanks, Frank. Final question from Marie before I bring in Faisal and then Emma Roddick.
Thank you. Does the panel welcome the approach to encouraging and supporting the submission of further evidence? Given the DWP's experience, what more can be done to get the message out that a different approach will be taken around evidence gathering? I'll just pop that to whoever can answer it.
Craig Smith, please.
Yeah, very briefly, for me, we definitely welcome the approach, the different approach in Scotland to evidence gathering for ADP compared to PIP and the reserve benefits. So I think the onus being on the agency to collect kind of one formal piece of evidence, and that to be on the balance of probabilities and not have to prove every little bit of criteria, is a very positive development. So I think, again, it kind of goes back to the past point around engagement with the third sector to ensure there's awareness of that, to ensure people know that the processes around ADP are going to be different from PIP. And that is a very positive process change around the responsibility for evidence gathering and that being much more upon the agency rather than the individual, and also the role of evidence from families and carers having equal value. So I think there's really important work, and I think the agency is doing a really good job actually about engaging with the sector around these changes and making that more public awareness. So that'll be an ongoing process as ADP is introduced and is going to be really key in that public awareness. And I think the third sector and others working with people with disabilities have a really key kind of partnership role in that, and ensuring that people know that the processes around evidence gathering, for example, but particularly around assessments, will be very different under ADP, and it's about how we can share that information and build people's confidence to engage with the system.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Keith Park, please, followed by Bill Scott.
Again, I agree with most of what, if not in fact all of what Craig said. It's definitely something that we welcome, the fact that it's only one piece of evidence and the onus is on Social Security Scotland to gather that. One of the issues that we've been aware of across the MS community before, when it's been the MS person with MS trying to gather that information, is they want that information to come from the neurologist or MS nurse, and they're adding to their workload incredibly so, and MS nurses report that they're getting so much contact from people around benefits, applications and support for that. So anything that improves that system has to be welcome from their perspective. Also, again, as Craig had said, the fact that somebody's carer and family member can provide that support to actually demonstrate the impact that the condition has on them on a day-to-day basis that a professional wouldn't necessarily be able to tease out has to be a positive thing.
Thank you, Keith. Bill Scott, briefly, before I take in Faisal Chowdhury.
Yeah, very briefly. I think one of the best ways of encouraging take-up and letting people know that the system's changed is word of mouth. And some of the early reports that we've been having from some of the pilot areas where the child disability payment's been rolled out is that the local office staff of the Scottish Social Security Agency have been leaning over backwards to help families access child disability payment. That gets around the disability community like nothing else, because people are active on social media and talk to one another. And I think it definitely indicates a very different approach to what people had experienced with the DWP. So you know, I hope the good news continues in that sense, and that people continue to have good experiences, because that will sell and get people to claim the benefits they're entitled to.
Thanks, Bill. Faisal Chowdhury, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I've just had a small question. Have you had any communication from the Scottish Government on process to make amendments, and does the panel accept that Scottish Government's argument that change to eligibility should be left to the independent review?
Anyone in particular for that, Faisal?
No, I mean, I'll leave it to the panel, whoever wants to answer that.
Looking for an R in the chat box from anyone in particular that would like to come in briefly to respond to that. Keith Park, please.
To answer the first part, we've not had any conversations or discussions with the Scottish Government around amendments. However, as it's been discussed, I think, in both panels so far this morning, we believe that some minor tweaks around the eligibility criteria could be made now. The issue around passporting benefits, especially in the 20 metres meter rules concerned, we don't believe that anybody who's on the enhanced rate of mobility will qualify for further passported benefits when compared, EWP benefits, sorry, when compared to somebody who's on the standard rate of mobility. As Bill mentioned earlier, a lot of what people are passported to are devolved benefits, that will be part of that, either the ADP system through the mobility component or through the blue badge system. We have a petition that's currently in front of the Citizens Participation and Petitions Committee, and as part of that process, they've written to both the DWP and the Scottish Government asking for specific examples of where the enhanced rate of mobility would passport you to further benefits, and neither organisation has taken that opportunity to give examples of where that would be have an impact. So yes, we definitely believe that some minor tweaks around the eligibility criteria could take place just now.
Thank you. Tricia Hatt, please, followed by Frank McKillop.
Yeah, I think one of the positive was about the Scottish Government making amendments to who can sign the form for end-of-life care benefits. Initially, it was clinicians. That's now been extended to registered nurses. So that has been a very positive support.
Thanks, Tricia. Frank McCart, and then I'll bring in Emma Roddick, I think.
Thanks. Yes, I think our concern, I think as we alluded to earlier, would be that if the opportunity is not taken to make, as Keith had outlined, just minor tweaks to these regulations and to the eligibility criteria, if we don't take that opportunity now, then we could have a situation that for several years, potentially, there are eligibility criteria that perhaps that the majority of Parliament, let alone the wider population and the wider sector, feel are unfair, will remain in place and will continue to be to the detriment of people with disabilities who are applying for these benefits. And I think that would obviously not be an outcome that would be in anyone's interest. So I do feel there's an opportunity here to make sure we've got the eligibility criteria right. There may not be, you know, there may be the fear in terms of the safe and secure transfer process that we can't do anything revolutionary at this point. But there are those tweaks that can be made. Otherwise, we will have that very undesirable situation where criteria that there's broad agreement are unfair, are continuing to disadvantage disabled people for some years into the future, despite what should have been the advantages of devolving this benefit.
Thanks, Frank. Bill Scott, briefly.
Pete, anything. Just to say, you know, Inclusion Scotland are involved in a number of stakeholder groups, which are in regular discussion with Scottish Government around changes. It's been a far easier argument to have them around process than it has about changing eligibility criteria, and largely for the reasons that Scottish Government have set out in their policy memorandum accompanying the draft regulations. So, you know, they have been concentrating on safe and secure transfer, but we, like the other organisations around this table, believe that some changes could be made in the here and now, and should be made in the here and now, because they're disadvantaging disabled people to such a great extent that they result in unfairness and should be addressed.
Thank you very much indeed, Bill. Emma Roddick, please, followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you. This question is for Craig. I noticed that the SAMH response says the assessment issues are the most significant problem for mental health patients applying for PIP. Would you agree that the changes that have been made in terms of assessment amount to a massive change in the experience of disabled claimants with a mental health issue even before eligibility is even considered?
Craig Smith.
Yes, it would be a short answer to that. I think they will make, I don't know if they'll make massive changes, but we are very confident that there will be significant positive changes arising from how eligibility is going to be assessed and the move away from a kind of default face-to-face assessment position with functional assessments and informal observations under PIP to what seems to be a much more positive system under ADP. We welcome the move away from face-to-face assessments, and we have been involved in discussions through membership of Disability and Expert Advisory Group, as well as research sessions with the Scottish Government directly around how the consultations under ADP will work. And there seems to be a broad move away from face-to-face towards phone consultations, not assessments, if required, and a more paper-based determination of eligibility, which we think is really welcome, particularly some small, not small, actually very important issues for people. Things like the move away from informal observations is really key, or where an assessor makes an informal observation under ADP, they will need to disclose that to the person that they're speaking to in the consultation and allow that person to respond. We know that's been a real issue for people with mental health problems, where they have experienced under PIP having their appearance judged, their manner of speech judged as not being what someone would expect someone with a mental health problem to look like or sound like, and that's been really distressing and hugely stigmatising. So we hope that the move away from a reliance on things like informal observations will be really helpful, and the move away just from an assessment process to a consultation process where it's more about a bespoke gathering of evidence where there's gaps in someone's application rather than the implementation of kind of functional assessments and the kind of standard questions. And particularly, we're really happy with the suitably qualified assessor criteria from the original Social Security Act and how that's being applied in ADP, where someone who's carrying out a consultation will need to have experience of directly working with people with mental health problems where the applicant has a mental health problem. We think that will make a really big change. Obviously, this is taking on faith at the moment, so we're, as I say, we're really positive about it. We will need to see how it works in practice, and I think that'll be a role for the independent review and ongoing kind of quality assurance and ongoing improvements to the system that this is always taken under review, and how consultations work in practice, that we gather really good evidence around that and particularly people's experience of that and clients' experience of that, so we can make further tweaks if necessary. But yes, to cut a long answer short, we do hope the change from assessments to consultations is a really positive, probably the most positive step in the changes from PIP to ADP.
Thanks. Emma Roddick.
Thank you for that answer. And I'm going to come back to you again, sorry. I notice as well in the submission, the retention of a points-based system is raised as something for the independent review to consider. Would you expect that to agree that a points-based system for determining need is appropriate? And if not, what would you propose instead?
Difficult question to answer. We have long-standing concerns with a point-based system that it kind of lacks a holistic approach to determining the impact of someone's disability or mental health problem on their daily living and mobility. I don't have a wonderful answer about what you'd replace it with, but we would like to see, I think we can take learning back from disability living allowance and different models of assessing the impact that someone's disability has or the impact that society has on disabled people, because I think we need to be taking a much more kind of social model to disability when we're looking at how we're assessing the impact of disability. I don't have a perfect answer. I would like to see consideration, full consideration in the independent review of alternatives to a point-based system, because it is very limiting at the moment and kind of doesn't have that holistic approach which we would like to see. going forward. So yeah, don't have a great answer on me, but it should be a kind of key focus for the independent review to look at, you know, in a very wide way, alternatives to how we determine eligibility for disability benefits.
Thanks, Craig. Miles Briggs, and we can hopefully bring Bill Scott in as part of that answer.
Thank you, Convener. I know we're tight for time. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask a question with regards to the independent review and what witnesses' expectations are around the review, both in terms of scope, remit and working practices, and when would you expect that work to be completed in a timely fashion? Maybe bring Bill in to start.
Thank you. Bill Scott.
Thanks, Miles. I think, as indicated earlier, I think a review, if it is to properly take evidence from those that use the system, as well as, you know, evidence from those who are involved in assisting those who use the system, so welfare rights workers, you know, advocacy organisations, etc., I would expect it to last around a year to do its job properly. I think that's an issue. Can I just on the assessments one now, to go back to an issue that was raised? I think it's quite important. I think there's been really positive changes in the assessment system. As people have pointed out, the proof of the pudding will be in the eating. But I do think it's still an ongoing concern that a care assistant with 2 years' experience, maybe of working with older people with dementia, will still be able to make an assessment of somebody with a mental health issue, even though, you know, their level of qualification is an SQA2. Whereas, you know, the complaints that around the PIP system have been that consultants have been overruled in their assessment of somebody's mental health by, you know, a midwife, etc. So there's still going to be that, you know, contradiction there at the heart of things, that somebody with relatively limited experience and quite low qualification level could overrule somebody who has spent their life and has risen in the profession through their ability to diagnose a mental health condition and are still overruled. So, and in the points-based system, I think it could be improved. There's not necessarily a logic to how the number of points are awarded for certain criteria and not others. So, you know, maybe an improved point-based system could be developed.
Thanks, Bill. Briefly, Keith Park, before I bring Miles back in.
Again, I agree with everything that Bill said, especially around the qualifications aspect for people who are undertaking the consultations. One of the things that we regularly hear from people living with MS is that their GP doesn't really understand the condition and all the symptoms that come with it because they don't have a huge amount of experience of working with people with MS. So for somebody with 2 years' experience of social care, the chances that they've come across somebody with a complex condition such as MS or ME with invisible symptoms is unlikely. I think in terms of the length of time for the review, a year's probably appropriate. In terms of the information and the scope of the review, I think to do it properly, it may even take longer than that to make sure that we gather as much information about the system as we possibly can. Again, looking at the assessment, we agree that there's been positive changes to the assessment process, and as part of the consultation, those were brought in terms of how that assessment process has been carried out to ensure that people who have been impacted by the 20-metre rule and other such rules have more chance of getting the higher rate and enhanced rate of mobility. We need to be able to gather the data to find out if that's actually the case, because no matter how you ask the question, if you ask a question in a different way, you'll still get the same answer because the question hasn't changed.
Thanks, Keith. Miles Briggs.
Thanks, Convener. That's helpful, and I'll bring in Tricia and Craig, but also wanted to ask this point. Referring back to the first panel we had with regards to terminal illness, how does the panel believe there's the scope around recruitment for qualified people to support people with the application process we're going to see, and specifically organisations who, you know, like yourself at Macmillan Cancer, Tricia, how they can be included in that process? So I'll maybe bring you in, Tricia, and then Craig.
Tricia,
yeah, thanks Miles. Thanks, Miles. And yes, I think the experience that we've got supporting people with a palliative end-of-life care diagnosis, I think absolutely that these staff need to be supported with training. And looking at the staff that we support through within the Benefits Advisors, the Improving Cancer Journey, the support through training really helps them to understand the sensitivity, particularly from an end-of-life care physician. And for people now, just because of the new terminal illness criteria, that's going to be really, really important. And I think if Macmillan can support anything there, then very happy to do so. We've got lots of experience in doing that and supporting people. But I think for the staff, as daunting as it will be there, for them with only maybe 2 years experience in social care, they need to have the basis, which is around being able to have these conversations. Nurses are trained long in communication skills, looking at anticipatory care planning. I think these staff, Social Security Agency staff, DWP, need to also have that support to be able to have these difficult sometimes conversations with people.
Thanks, Tricia. Conscious of time, brief submissions from Craig and Frank, please.
Yeah, really brief from me in terms of the recruitment aspect. I suppose I don't have a very good answer about how challenging that will be, and I think we'll need to. I've not seen any kind of scoping from the Scottish Government or agency about, for example, how the numbers of people to carry out consultations and the impact that we'll have, considering the current social care and health workforce. But just to kind of reiterate points, it's really key that people with the right experience and qualifications are recruited into that role, and that goes back to Bill's point, which I would agree with. I think it needs, while there's very welcome legislative changes around that, we need to make sure that we are recruiting the right people to that, and the training is there for them. And I think that's a big role for the third sector to support the Scottish Social Security Agency around training people who are carrying out consultations and local staff as well who are supporting people to apply.
Thank you. Frank McCullough, please.
Thanks. Yeah, I think from our perspective that people who have experience in social care supporting people with a learning disability being part of the assessment process, that is something that we regard as a positive. Completely take the concerns about ensuring people are properly trained and understand that. I think a lot of the concern probably comes from the bad experience with PIP assessments. I think we tend to take a more positive view that someone who has experience of supporting someone who has the conditions or the symptoms that are presented will make a fairer assessment than has perhaps been the experience with the consultants that the contracts have gone to for PIP assessments. So take on board the concerns about ensuring people are properly trained and qualified, but we would consider that to be more positive that people have experience of supporting the people that they're seeing.
Thank you. Tricia Hatt.
It just the recent report, the Seldom Heard programme for end-of-life care that's just been published a few weeks ago, I think that clearly demonstrates the support, the strong support from third sector organisations and supporting staff in training. And these staff are skilled, but they also do need to have that very intense support through training, education and ongoing, not just as a one-off, it has to be ongoing.
Thank you very much. Just one final, very brief question for me, and it's predominantly to Keith Park, please, and that is to ask on issues like on eligibility, such as the 20-metre rule, do you believe that that will require reassessment on transfer? And could you give a reason for your thoughts on that, please? Keith.
It's one of the issues that we acknowledge is there in terms of how people go across. Because there's going to be a rolled transfer across, then I think that's something that would need to be addressed. I agree that it will develop a two-tier system, potentially, that people who come across have that assessment or have their position undertaken and reviewed, similar to having a light touch review, and whether they're able, how far they're able to walk. But I think that it's one of the issues that we've got an opportunity here to get an actually world-leading, rights-based social security system that actually supports people with disability to live independently. There may be some teething issues around transfer because of that, but I don't think that's something that we should be beholden to. I think we need to try and take the opportunity to get this right at the first opportunity, because as we've said throughout the discussions this morning, come 2023, when the review takes place, we're going to be in a very similar position in that the DWP will have criteria and there'll be passported benefits, issues around that. So we're not actually going to be in a position, a better position, to review the eligibility criteria at that stage. So I think the same issue will be a case then. So yes, I think there may be some issues around how that works out in terms of reassessment, but make sure that people get the support that they need as quickly as possible. I think it's important that we do it now.
Thank you very much indeed, and I can see that Bill is concurring with that. I really want to thank you all, Craig Smith, Frank McKillop, Keith Park, Tricia Hatt and Bill Scott, for your time this morning. Really insightful evidence, really helpful to the work that we're doing around ADP. That concludes, and I want to thank you for your time. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. Next week, the committee will take evidence on the budget. And I suspend this meeting now and move to private session, and in the meantime wish you all a very Merry Christmas. Thank you. I invite members to join the private session via the link provided. Thank you.